Thank you. Good morning. Welcome to the house of the Lord. How is it with your souls? Good. Happy New Year, right? When our kids were little, I believe it's been a long time, there was a book that we had read to them. I think it was called Too Much Christmas. I don't know if people had too much Christmas, too much New Year's, or what, but it's good to see your faces here today. But before we get started, a couple things. First, my family and I would like to thank you for your very generous Christmas gift this year. We do really appreciate it, so thank you for that. The other thing, there's other things in your bulletins. Please look at those and read them. But the couple things I want to highlight is not this Tuesday, but next Tuesday on the 11th, I will be restarting my Tuesday morning Bible study. We're still in the book of Revelation. We're getting to the end, but we're still in the book of Revelation. We'll be starting that. And then Wednesday, the next day, Wednesday evening at 6:30, I'm starting an evening Bible study. And it's called That the World May Know. It's by Ray Vanderlaan. And he takes us to the lands of the Bible. And he films there, and he talks to us about how things, you know, came about. And you'll get to see some of these places and some of these things. And then he shows us how it's relevant to our lives today. And this is going to be an ongoing study. There's no books, there's no payment, there's no homework. Just come and participate in the discussion and learn. And you don't have to worry about it building upon, you know, each lesson building upon the next. They're all different. And so if you miss this week, you can come to this one and just learn from there. So I pray that you'll consider being a part of these Bible studies and enhancing your knowledge of the Bible, of God, and of God's plan in your life. At this time, we have some important church work to do. You know, the church, this place does not operate on its own. And I don't do everything in the church. Sometimes it feels like it. But I know I don't. I'm not that good or organized. And so I need help to do things. And therefore, we have committees, we have chairpersons, And these folks really make the church run, and I'm so appreciative of their gifts, their talents, and the work they do. And beginning today, there are new people coming on, taking over the chair of things, and we want to recognize them and actually bless them. So if you are a chair of a ministry or you are a committee member, would you please stand? Thank you. Thank you. Dear friends, you have been called by God and chosen by the people of God for leadership in the church. This ministry is a blessing and a serious responsibility. It recognizes your special gifts and calls you to work among us and for all of us. In love, we thank you for accepting your obligation and challenge you to offer your best to the Lord, to his people, and to our ministry to the world. Live a life in Christ and make him known in your witness and your work. Do you this day acknowledge yourself a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ? Will you devote yourself to the service of God in the world? Will you so live that you enable this church to be a people of love and peace? Will you do all in your power to be responsible to the task for which you have been chosen?
I will.
Will you pray with me? Almighty God, pour out your blessing upon these your servants who have been given particular ministries in your church. Grant them grace to give themselves wholeheartedly in your service. Keep before them the example of our Lord, who did not think first of himself, but gave himself for all of us. Let them share his ministry and consecration that they may enter into his joy. Guide them in their work. Reward them their faithfulness with the knowledge that through them your purposes are accomplished through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now, dear friends, rejoice that God provides laborers for the vineyard. Will you do all in that you can to assist and encourage these individuals in their responsibilities to which they have been called, giving them your cooperation, your counsel, and your prayers? And with that, we thank you for your service. Thank you very much. And I look forward to working with all of you. All right. Now, my friends, let us begin worship in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord, and we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving, and we sacrifices of joy.
In our opening hymn, the First Noel. seated. Please join with me in the prayer of the day. Glorious God, Lord of light, today you reveal to your people of faith the radiance of your word made flesh. Your light is strong, your love is near. Draw us beyond the limitations which the world imposes to the life where your spirit makes all life complete. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please continue your prayers in the silence of your hearts. In the book of John, it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." Please join me in the prayer that he taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This time that we would normally receive our offerings. We encourage you to continue to put your offerings in the boxes in the back of the church. But during this time, pray and think about things that you may be able to do for your church and for the good news of the Lord Jesus. pray with me the prayer of dedication? Gracious God, I dedicate these gifts to your kingdom work and my life to you as a living sacrifice, bringing all my actions under the atoning blood of Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, come and fill your temple. Amen. Please be seated.
As we prepare for our prayer hymn, Jesus was born, and we just celebrated his birth. The shepherds and the wise men, they left then, and they shared this good news with people who weren't Jewish, with people who were beyond their borders, and they had to figure out how to do that. And today, people continue to try to figure out how to share the good news with people of other languages and other cultures. And in the 1800s, a Jesuit missionary trying to share the gospel of Jesus Christ and his birth with the Huron people wrote a poem called "Twas in the Moon of Wintertime," or the Huron Carol. And although it's not historically accurate, it does share with an indigenous people the gospel of Jesus in a way that they could understand. And so, no, there are no kings showing up to them, but there are chiefs. And there's no frankincense and gold, but there are fox and beaver pelts, things that were expensive and meant something to them. So as we sing this prayer hymn, continue to think of how you can share the gospel in the context of the people you come in contact with.
Your king is born. Jesus is born in excelsis.
Almighty Spirit of us all. Lord, we continue the celebration of the birth of your Son. And Lord, as the shepherds and the wise men went forth and proclaimed this glorious birth and good news to those around them, so have faithful people tried to follow your command to share the gospel to all the corners of the earth. To do that, we need to sometimes enter into their place, into their world and their culture, and use terminology that relates to them, that they understand, much like you did with the parables. And so, Lord, we thank you for the Huron Carol and for those who took it forth to that corner of the world. Now, Lord, as we go into the different corners of our world, into our workplaces, onto our sports fields, into our homes, and into our friends, Lord, may we find ways to enter into their lives and share the gospel in a way that they will understand as well. We pray that your Spirit goes with us. Give us the creativity, Lord, and the courage to go forth with this message. Lord, strengthen us in our own personal faith and strengthen us as a church to be a light to the world, to our community around us. Lord, we thank you for being with us, honoring us with your presence, for the gift of healing, for the gift of comfort, and for the gift of faith. Lord, your love never ends, and we cannot thank you enough. But we try by going forth and telling others about this incredible joy that we have, that they may enter into your love as well. All of these things we give you thanks and praise for. In the name of the child born in Bethlehem, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
please join me in the prayer of illumination? God of light, illuminate your word through your Holy Spirit. Let the good news radiate from these pages. Let your epiphany, grace, break into our hearts and minds. Captivate all who hear these words, that we might believe and go forth in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. A reading from Numbers. So he uttered his oracle, saying, "The oracle of Balaam, son of Beor, the oracle of the man whose eye is clear, the oracle of one who hears the words of God and knows the knowledge of the Most High, who sees the visions of the Almighty, who falls down but with his eyes uncovered. I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near. A star shall come out of Jacob, and a scepter shall rise out of Israel." And from Isaiah, "Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For darkness shall cover the earth, and the thick darkness of the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look around. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried on their nurses' arms. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill and rejoice because of the abundance of the sea shall be brought to you. The wealth of the nation shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah. All those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord."
From the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 2. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born of the Jews? For we have observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.' Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, 'Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may go and pay homage.' When they heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. Upon entering the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary and knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chest, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road." And there, it's not in there, but I decided to add it this morning, continuing. "Now, after they left, the angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, 'Get up, take the child and his mother, and flee to Egypt, and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him.'" This is the word of God for the people of God. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thursday is January 6th. What is that? Epiphany. It's Epiphany, which means that Christmas season will finally officially be over. For my family, that means that all the presents that are currently scattered across the living room and the kitchen table need to be put away back in their, or up to their rooms. And over the next several days, the trees and decorations will start to be taken down for another year. Some of the gifts that we received, we'll use them time and time again. And others, well, like a pair of old socks, will get thrown over our shoulder, and that'll be the end of it. There is one gift, though, that just seems like it never goes away, and that is fruitcake. These things are just, they're heavy and so sweet that you can really only eat one bite a week. That is if you even like them. And I've wondered, what is it about fruitcake that makes them last so long? So I decided to do some research, and I found some very interesting information. As far as researchers can tell, fruitcakes date back to the ancient Egyptians and Romans. Why do fruitcakes last so long? Because they were considered by the Egyptians to be an essential food for the deceased in the afterlife. And so they were created to last a long time within the tombs. Because of their long shelf life, fruitcake also was a perfect food for Roman soldiers on long pilgrimages. And if they ran out of boulders, they could just load the fruitcake into the catapults to knock the walls down. Actually, the longevity of fruitcake is because of two ingredients, salt and alcohol. And although all fruitcakes don't have alcohol, the ones that last the longest, they're soaked in the stuff. In 2003 on The Tonight Show, Jay Leno sampled a fruitcake that dated back to 1878. So we can thank the Egyptians for the gift that keeps on giving. Actually, the gift that keeps on giving is the child whose birth we have been celebrating, the child whose family fled to the land of Egypt to escape Herod's bloodbath, which makes me wonder if Jesus ever tasted fruitcake when he was in Egypt. But wait, we're slightly ahead of ourselves here. For today is the first Sunday of Epiphany, a day that we celebrate the arrival of the Magi. From biblical records, we know very little about these men, who they were, their names, where they came from, and how many of them there actually were. And we know even less about what they did after they left Bethlehem. We know that they came from the east, and it is widely held that they were from Persia. Church history and all the early depictions of the Magi have them dressed in silky Persian clothing. We know that they were men of great knowledge and were given the title Magi. They were respected for their knowledge of astrology and astronomy and law and philosophy and medicine and science and physics and religion. We know that they brought and presented gifts of frankincense, gold, and myrrh. We know that they worshiped the Christ child. But that's all we know of them, and that's not a whole lot, is it? There is one more thing, though, that we do know about the Magi, and that is that they did not stay in Bethlehem. As a matter of fact, no one in the Christmas story stayed in Bethlehem. The angels returned to heaven. The shepherds went out back to their fields, out beyond Bethlehem. The Magi went home to the east. And in that same night, Mary and Joseph took the Christ child and fled to Egypt. Jesus himself grew up, lived, and ministered somewhere other than Bethlehem. They all came to Bethlehem and celebrated Christ's birth, just as we have. But none of them stayed. They all moved beyond Bethlehem. And that is the point of today's message. We too need to move beyond Bethlehem. Christmas is a special time of year, isn't it? Things change. People change. Well, at least for a month or so, anyhow. And for most people, those changes are good. There's, you know, the pretty decorations, the festive packages and music. People send cards of goodwill and well wishes. People tend to be merrier, more generous, more kind. Perhaps they put aside grudges for just a bit of time. Wars have been even known to cease during Christmas Eve. And because of all these things, people look forward to the Christmas season. They decorate as soon as Thanksgiving's over. They start playing the Christmas music because they just want to immerse themselves in the season of Christmas. Now, for some people, the day after Christmas, the decorations are put away, the trees come down, and the house is put back to normal order. I personally think it is good to continue to celebrate and remain in Bethlehem for a short while to ponder what we have experienced. And so I enjoy the 12 days of Christmas, which began on Christmas Day and end on January 5th. Today is the ninth day of Christmas. And then on January 6th is Epiphany and the end, and we start to undecorate. Some people, however, try to hold on to Christmas for as long as they possibly can, putting off the undecorating and turning off the lights. And I admit I'm guilty of that, all right? But like everyone else in this story, there comes a point where we need to move beyond Bethlehem. 6 weeks ago, we started a journey on the first week of Advent, and it led us to the manger in Bethlehem. But our journey did not end there. It continues beyond Bethlehem, and we continue on in our journey. And in 9 weeks, we will approach the first Sunday of Lent, which will then lead us to Easter. But even Easter is not the end of our journey, for we are called then by Christ to go into the world and share this joy that we know, to share the good news. So my question for this morning, the questions are, how do we move on, and where do we go from here? And I believe it's a simple answer, and that is, we simply go back to life. We go back to normal work weeks. Kids go back to school. Furniture that was displaced to make room for decorations and trees is put back in its proper place. Meetings and Bible studies and small groups that were suspended for the holidays go back to their regular schedules. Evenings that were filled with baking cookies and buying presents and visiting are now back to being open nights just to relax. And we go back to watching our regularly scheduled TV programs instead of Christmas specials. The shepherds, they went back to their sheep. And the Magi went back to their homes in the east. They went back to what was familiar and normal, and yet it wasn't quite the same anymore. The shepherds and Magi returned home, and everything was still the same as when they left, and yet it was different because they were now different. Their worldview was now different. Did the shepherds return to their flocks and see their jobs and sheep and themselves differently? Scripture doesn't tell us, but I believe that they probably did. Those who were despised and considered unclean and untrustworthy were the first ones entrusted with the good news of salvation. Those who had no hope and were kicked around and things, they now had hope, and they felt like a child of God. They came quietly and timidly and humbly, but Scripture tells us they left dancing and celebrating and praising God and telling everyone what they had seen and heard. As I said earlier, Scripture is silent on the Magi after they left in the night, but church historians and ancient writers and church tradition tell us that the Magi, they became ingrained in the Christian church. after Bethlehem, Persians knew of and some later practiced Christianity. On the day of Pentecost in Jerusalem, Persians were told, join the church that day after hearing Peter preach. And early church records show that Thaddeus and Bartholomew evangelized to the Persians. And by the way, that is modern-day Iran and Iraq. Archaeologists have discovered depictions of the Magi in Christian catacombs and on bone boxes dating back to the early late 200s. It is thought by some scholars that the sarcophagus depicting the Magi were of Gentiles who converted to Christianity like the Magi did. There is an apocryphal book not accepted in the biblical canon called The Revelation of the Magi, which supposedly records the work of the Magi once they left Bethlehem. Then this and other records claim that the Magi went back to Persia and shared what they knew about this new king, about the Christ. The second oldest known Christian church is the Church of St. Mary's in Iran. Marco Polo recorded that he worshiped there. Another Christian church in northwest Iran dates back to 66 AD. So you can see Christianity was in the Persian area. And most likely because the Magi went back. The Persians originally worshiped Zoroaster. But for a short time, many became Christians until Islam took over. It is written by one ancient historian that Thomas found the Magi when he left to share the gospel in India, and he baptized them and made them priests. They later were killed for their faith, and their remains were buried near Tehran. Marco Polo records that he was shown their tombs. Later in 390 AD, their remains were moved to Constantinople in Turkey, and finally in 1164 to Cologne, Germany, where their remains rest today. After celebrating the first Christmas, the Magi did not remain in Bethlehem. They returned home, and everything was like it had been when they left, but they were different. They continued to seek knowledge. However, they now perceived science and philosophy and religion and law and medicine and astronomy through a new lens, a different light. For the light of Christ had opened up their heart, their minds, and their souls. They had an epiphany. The light came on. That's what happens when one truly encounters the Christ. They go away different than when they came. They see the world, one another, and God differently and more fully. We too have gone to Bethlehem, and we have celebrated the birth of Christ, and like all the others, we must now move beyond Bethlehem. Like the shepherds and Magi, we must go back to the same life we left, but like them, we can make differences. We may go back to the same lives, but they don't have to stay the same. We can make changes. We, having been to Bethlehem, having celebrated Christmas, can take the love and joy and excitement that we experience into the same old workplaces, into our schools, into restaurants and our sports teams and our homes and our families and our lives and it can change and make things different. The Magi had some of the Old Testament prophecies, partially because for 70 years the Israelites were in exile in Babylon. And so some of that the people stayed, and some of that resonated with them. Also, as we read in Numbers, one of their ancient early ancestors, Balaam, remember him and his talking donkey? Well, he was sent by King Balak to curse Israel, but God intervened, and Balaam then instead, he blessed them. And he offered up one of the very first messianic prophecies. I see him, but not now. I see him, but not near. But a star shall rise up, a scepter shall rise, and he shall lead his people. The ancient Persians, they had some knowledge of Jesus. They had some prophecies. They saw a star and they followed it, and it led them to a child, not of noble birth in a palace, but of poor parents in a peasant's home. And I wonder how they knew for sure that he was the right one. But they must have, because they left their extravagant gifts with him. They worshiped him. And then they went home, and they led the Christian church in Persia, eventually giving up their lives for faith in a child that they had only seen for a very short while on one single night. We, on the other hand, we have all the Old Testament prophecies, all the witnesses of the New Testament. We know that the child grew, taught, ministered, performed miracles. We know that Jesus suffered and died for our sins. He died, resurrected, ascended to heaven, and has promised to return for us. And we see how the Christian church has grown and survived for over 2,000 years. We have so much more evidence to believe in than the Magi did. And so my question is, what will we do with this information? What will we do with our faith? Will we essentially spiritually stay in Bethlehem, keeping our mouths closed, internally reflecting on and enjoying the birth of Christ, but never letting him leave the manger, never letting him grow up, never letting him change us? Or do we go beyond Bethlehem, going back to our normal lives, glorifying and praising God, taking the love, joy, and excitement that we have experienced of Christmas into every corner of our lives? If we choose to stay in Bethlehem, nothing will ever change. But if we, like the Magi, move beyond Bethlehem, taking Christ with us, everything changes. Because the way we look at our jobs, our hobbies, our friends, our families, our community, our churches, and even our own very lives, it all changes with Christmas. What we once perceived through the eyes of the world, we now see and understand through a new lens, through the eyes of Christmas and the cross of Easter. We can change and better our lives. We can change and better the church. We can change and better our communities. We can even change and better the world. If we stay in Bethlehem, we're going to be alone because, well, everyone else left. Jesus even walked away and he said, "Come, follow me." We have a world to change. Yesterday, we celebrated the beginning of a new year. Out with the old, in with the new, right? It's a new year. Anything is possible, especially in light of Christmas. So what do you say? Let's do it. Let's make this the year that we make some changes for Christ. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for today and the memories and the stories of those who came on that first Christmas and saw you and experienced you and worshiped you. But like them, Lord, help us to move beyond Bethlehem. Help us to go forth as they did, glorifying and praising God and telling everyone about what we have seen and experienced, the things that we know, that Christmas can continue throughout the year and not end on January 5th, but continue in our hearts and in our minds in the way that we interact with one another. Lord, may Christmas strengthen our faith for the days ahead, and may we be children who have received such a glorious gift. This we ask in your holy name. Amen. Jesus was born. The Word became flesh. And it was laid on a plate, the food box of an animal. Jesus was called the bread of life. And he was born in the town of Bethlehem, which means house of bread. He told his disciples that he was the bread of life. And on the night he was betrayed, he took the bread and broke it and said, "This is my body. I am the bread. It is broken for you." Christmas continues. Each and every time we celebrate Holy Communion, we take the bread and we remember the bread of life that was laid in a manger in the house of bread and was broken for us, that we may have eternal life. Let us prepare our hearts to receive Holy Communion. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give them our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivering us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body of Christ and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Friends, the table is set, and I invite you to come to the manger and partake of the bread of life. Please come. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for this day of worship, for continuing the celebration of Christmas. And Lord, we thank you for your Son, Jesus, the bread of life. Now that we have come to the manger and partaken of the bread of life, may we go forth into this world truly as the body of Christ, that they may know of the joy that we have and of the love that is available for them. Lord, help us to go forth as the Magi and the shepherds, dancing and celebrating, glorifying and praising your name, and telling everyone all that we know. This we ask in your holy name. Amen. And now, will you, before we leave here today, let us Let us continue the journey with the Magi. Will you please stand and join me in our closing hymn? Sing that song and not sway, right? My friends, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit go with you. Go forth, O wise people. Go forth, shepherds, and share the love of God with those you encounter. Amen. Amen. Amen.